Blog Talk Radio.
Outler, and we'll be here for the next hour. It is Monday, April the 29th, 2019. Hope everyone's new week is off to a good start thus far. Looking forward to tonight's episode. I have a guest lined up in the following segment. Juliet Vandermolen is going to be joining the program to talk about her forthcoming book from Animal Heart Press that's set to be released next month called Mother May I. And she'll be discussing that project and reading a few pieces from the collection. So looking forward to that conversation. And we'll also have open phone lines in the remainder of the show at 646-668-8757. And I'll give that number out again later on in the program. Wanted to mention here at the top a couple of recent episodes. Had some great guests on and really enjoyed talking this past Saturday with Mark Ziegens, who was on talking about his latest book, Typewriter Underground, and the inspirations behind that collection, some of the awesome characters he came up with. And then in the episode before that, had a local Atlanta poet and a friend of mine, Michael Burke, on the program, who was talking about his poetry, but also the spiritual path that he's gone down in the second half of his life, the last 30 years, and that was a very intriguing conversation, resonated with me deeply. Poetry and spirituality, two of my favorite subjects in the world, and so I wanted to invite listeners, if you're interested in checking out those episodes, you can find them at the 17 Numa Radio Archive, also at my website, 17numa.com, and you can subscribe to this channel. It's free and easy. Just hit the follow button found above the slideshow on the page where this episode is streaming right now, and that'll get you in the loop to receive notifications for upcoming episodes. I did also want to mention that my latest collection of Sand and Sugar was published last week through Cyberwit out of India, and so that is available now through the publisher and on Amazon, and I also have some personalized copies on hand at the moment. If anyone would like to pick one of those up, just shoot me a message or contact me at 17numa@gmail.com. That helps to fund this show and helps me travel around to some of the events here in Atlanta and elsewhere, so I do greatly appreciate that, and your support of independent presses and authors goes a long way. Thought to kick off the show here tonight, I would read a quick piece from the collection. This one originally appeared at Dissident Voice, where I'm a weekly contributor, going on the 5-year anniversary of that fact coming up in just a couple of months. So thought this would be an appropriate piece to start off with tonight. It's called Blue Pines. I consulted my stars during a dry spell in the plains. They told me to lie down in the grass, make a blanket of the leaves, told me to build a fire in the season when the sky grows cold, told me age is just a number until it kills you, warm in the bones where the ache melts, told me the trees will always love you but they alone cannot protect from a storm, told me that even saints will cheat when they're trying to save the soul of a sinner, told me clocks of time are just illusions, so add another hour when you're feeling slow. I spoke to my ghost in the night with the moon hung low. They told me every choice leads to another, but don't forget to breathe. We'll be back on the other side. Back to Songs of Salah. That was the Yeah Yeah Yeahs with Warrior. Coming up on the program next Monday on May 6th at 9 p.m. Eastern, I'm going to be joined by poet Matt Borzone to talk about all the amazing books that he has out. Seems like he's putting them out every few months at this point, with his work inspired by his time over in Afghanistan and dealing with the PTSD, very important poet in these times. And so urge everyone to tune in to that episode. But here tonight, I'm pleased to be joined by Juliet Vandermolen, who is on the phone to talk about her upcoming collection. Juliet, are you there?
Hi, Scott.
Hi, how are you this evening?
I'm doing great. How are you?
Doing very well, thank you. Nice to speak with you. I guess you want to talk a little bit about your new book, Mother May I, and what inspired the collection and how the whole process is unfolding working there with Animal Heart Press?
Sure. I mean, it's still all a little bit surreal. It's my first collection coming out, and I have the print book in my hand, and I still can't believe it sometimes. I guess the inspiration for the collection came from the title poem, Mother May I, which was part of me working through some childhood trauma and some trauma with my mother and working towards healing. I didn't expect it to be a book when I wrote that poem. And I guess that poem really sort of galvanized me into action to say, like, I have a story that I need to tell, and I have truth that I need to tell. And there was really a lot of power in being able to give words to what had happened to me and what I had gone through. But I also realized, too, that now as a mother myself with grown children, that I kind of see both sides of it. So kind of like what the expectations are of motherhood in society and the pressures that are there and how we don't always get to be, I guess, our individual selves. Once we become mothers, you sort of take on this mantle of motherhood, and nobody really knows what that's supposed to be, but there are all these kind of ideals out there that are pretty hard to live up to.
The greatest sacrifice any human being could have, I think, is being a mother. So do you explore those different roles that people, or perceptions that people have about motherhood in the collection?
Yeah, I think, you know, it was really inspired reading the essay from Adrienne Rich. She writes an essay called A Woman Born, and it's about motherhood as an experience in an institution. And a lot of what the book deals with is trauma. And sometimes that trauma is on the part of the children. It can be on the part of the mother. There are certainly documentary poems in here where I discuss mothers that are pretty well known, Mother of the Menendez Brothers. A lot of different mothers who experienced their own traumas coming into motherhood, who experienced mental illness, some with one chosen by proxy or all kinds of things. And there's a big stigma in letting anyone know that you have any kind of problem as a mother. You know, we're supposed to kind of have it all together. And sometimes the consequence of that is that we sort of break down. And that's not something that anybody really wants to talk about. And then when that happens, terrible things happen. And it's terrible for the mothers, but it's even worse for the children. And then the children, you know, carry those traumas on into their life, and they affect their own families when they have them. So I definitely explore some of that. It's a big part of the book.
Well, I think that's absolutely important to get those discussions out there. And when you look at it just on the face of what birth is, it's a traumatic experience of the inherent suffering of life right off the bat. I mean, the baby comes out screaming, gasping for air. The mother is in horrible pain. It's just like, this is what life is. Welcome. So
it's pretty much like you could not imagine what it's like unless you've been through it. Like, you just, no words can really do that experience justice. I mean, I love my kids. I had my son 18 days after I turned 18, and I certainly wasn't prepared to be a mother. I wasn't prepared for the trauma of all of that, and it was really, really difficult. I have also twins that I had 5 years later, So all my kids are grown now and almost out of college. But it's definitely not something that anyone tells you how to do or what the right thing to do is. And, it's interesting to me, this book, when Animal Heart Press first started talking to me about it, we decided that it would come out in May. And then I realized, oh, God, that's the month of Mother's Day.
Oh, wow, yeah.
So it wasn't planned that way, but we talked about moving it around, but it certainly felt like the right time to do it because, you know, Mother's Day comes around and we've got all these cards with flowers and breakfast in bed and all this kind of Hallmark moments, you know. And there certainly are moments like that with motherhood, but it's definitely not what the whole experience is like. And as much as I love my kids and I tell them that I love them, I also tell them that if I was rating parenthood on a Amazon rating, I'd probably give it like 1 star, and I don't think I would recommend it to too many people. It takes a lot of fortitude. It's not easy, you know, and it's not the fairy tale that kind of everybody makes it out to be, I guess, is the point. And the editor-in-chief for Animal Heart Press, Elizabeth Horan, is coming out with her own book in May called Bad Mommy, Stay Mommy, and it's about postpartum depression, which, again, is another aspect of motherhood and the trauma of birth that people don't want to talk about. So I think it's really important that we're having these conversations and saying, hey, there's some things here that we need to deal with, and as women, too, we need to be honest with each other so we don't feel so alone and can have some kind of support.
Absolutely. And when you're talking about your children now being adults, do you discuss this book with them, and how has that impacted your relationship with them, if so?
Yeah, I definitely do. My children are very aware of my poetry. One daughter regularly listens to my readings and gives me constructive criticism and feedback. But I wrote a poem in the book about when I had my son, and I discussed that poem with him, and I talked to him about that, and it really opened up a dialogue of, you know, things that we had never discussed before, you know, and it's hard to talk to your kids about how difficult it is to be a mother because you don't want them to think that you regret having them or anything like that. And it's not that at all, but it's just a matter of being honest and saying, hey, sometimes really wonderful things can also be really difficult things. And I think it's been a good experience for them to see me as, you know, more human, I guess. Sometimes we put our parents up on pedestals and that's just not realistic. So I hope that if they choose to have children someday, that they'll go into it with more open eyes and maybe not be as hard on themselves as I was on myself.
And just a side note, right now, anyone who's listening, after the show, call your mothers and tell them thank you.
Definitely.
So what was the process of writing the book? You said that it started from the title poem. Did you already have the rest of the poems written, or once you decided to do the book, did you then write those afterwards around the theme?
Well, it was really, so I had about, I think, 3 poems written, and they were just individual poems at the time, and I submitted them to James Diaz at Anti-Heroin Chic magazine, and Elizabeth was the poetry editor at the time there, and she read them, and she said, oh, my God, I love these, and I want them. I want them all. And then we started talking, and I said, I think I have some more to write about this. And she said, send me whatever you have. So I started writing more, and I started sending her pieces. And she said, you know, I think we both kind of discussed, you know, is there a book in here? Is there what we thought was going to be a chapbook at the time turned into a collection? So I got on board with Animal Heart Press as their first author, and they approached me. I was really surprised. But I was still writing the manuscript when they offered me the contract. So I wrote it pretty quickly, but I spent a lot of time with them kind of going over the poems and doing some editing and things like that. But it was, once the writing started, it's like I couldn't turn it off. You know, it really consumed me. And I probably ran through the first draft of the book in maybe 4 weeks' time. And I was just completely mentally exhausted after that. Like, I couldn't write anything. I couldn't think about anything else. And I had to take a little break from it before I went back to it again to do the editing. But that was kind of a whirlwind and very unexpected.
That does make sense, though, being such a personal subject, having those emotions that just needed to rush out almost as a cathartic process, it sounds like. So what is the plan for the book? Do you have any events upcoming for the launch? And where can people find out more about it if they want to order an advanced copy?
Sure. So if you want to order an advanced copy, they can go to my website, which is www.julietwright.com. And I have a bookstore on there. Copies are still technically available for pre-order. The release date is Wednesday, May 1st. On May 1st, I'll be in New York with Elizabeth, and we'll be at Pen and Brush, and I'll be reading poems from the book there, and sort of be having a little bit of a launch, and that is a gallery and a space that supports feminist presses and writers, and there'll be some other writers there reading That Night of Light, I believe three others. So we'll be kind of celebrating that there. And then I don't have a date yet, but I believe in July we are going to be in, Elizabeth and I are going to be in Philadelphia at a bookstore called A Novel Idea. And we'll be doing some reading there. I think her from she's got so many books coming out this year, I can't keep track. whichever book she has coming out at that time. And then I'll be reading some of Mother May I, and I'm hoping that they're going to carry the book as well. It will also be available on Amazon and through Barnes & Noble as well.
Awesome. And you were talking earlier about having the actual physical copy in your hands and what a surreal feeling that is. Is this event coming up in New York going to be the first time you've had a chance to read from it, or have you been able to do that already?
I've done some reading from it. I sort of ticked something off my bucket list. Right after I got a proof copy, I went into New York and to NoHo, and I read at Bowery Poetry, which was a hell of an experience and a lot of fun. That was the first time I read from the book in my hand, and it was crazy. I mean, it felt so good. But yeah, I've read in a few smaller venues around here in New Jersey, sort of preparing for New York, and I've had the book. And it's funny because I was at a poetry reading in Summit, New Jersey on Friday night, and I had the book, and someone said, "Oh, you're reading poetry?" And they said, "Whose poetry are you reading?" I said, "Well, it's mine." And they were like, "Oh, you have a book." So it's, you know, to me, it's I just kind of carry it around with me wherever I go now. So
absolutely.
So yeah, it's wonderful to have.
What is your inspiration, obviously, for this book itself? You've talked about that, but for poetry in general, and how long have you been writing?
Well, you know, I've been writing. I was always a prose writer, and I sort of, you know, I had my awkward moments with poetry when I was a teenager. Those kinds that you have in English class where you never want to repeat it again. And I kind of thought, you know, I'm just a prose writer. I can just write fiction, creative nonfiction. Poetry is not my thing, you know. I always felt really intimidated by it. And like it was so complicated and I didn't understand it. But I started writing some really short pieces on a site called Zabum.com, and they have these three-word prompts, and you can only use 55 words, and three of them have to be these words. And So I started writing these really short pieces, and it really makes you think about, you know, word choice and placement and how to create an image with limited space. And not that all poetry is like that. I have some really long poems now. But people always said to me, well, your prose is very poetic. And I just thought, oh, well, that just sounds nice. But apparently I kind of had all the makings of poetry. I just was not quite there yet. So once I started writing these shorter pieces, I started taking pieces, longer pieces that I had written and sort of doing my own erasure poetry with my own work and putting my prose together in a poetic form. And I found that it really spoke to me. And so I've only been writing poetry, serious poetry, I guess, for maybe a little over a year. I think it's been there for a really long time. I just sort of had to uncover it and be brave enough to put it out there. And the poetry community that's on Twitter and all of these literary magazines that have supported me have just been so encouraging. And I've learned so much from reading their poetry and then working on and submitting my own. It's really been a great experience. And I surprised myself, that's for sure.
That's a cool story. It really is awesome when you find the right venue to get into the poetry field, because a lot of people go through school and high school or college, whatever the case may be, reading the canon, and it's hard to find an entry into that poetry from bygone ages. And so then to see the contemporary field and how wide open it is and how many different communities there are and venues and how much inspiration there is out there to draw upon, it's really an exciting process to get into that field. So congratulations on all
Thank
the success
you.
You're having already and
Thank
on
you.
The new book coming out. And do you have a few pieces maybe that you'd like to preview from the book tonight?
Sure. I can read you the title poem, Mother May I, and then I'll read you the one about when I had my son. So it's kind of
okay.
Two sides of the coin. This one is the title poem, and it's kind of written, it was the one that inspired everything and really was empowering for me. I read this out loud in New York for the first time in Brooklyn last January, and writing words on the page is one thing, but speaking them out loud, I felt so energized by that and so empowered by it. It's kind of like magic. So I'll read that one for you. Mother, may I? Mother, may I ask you why it was so different to be firstborn? Did I alter you to this stretched and unreal smile? Or were you always unhappy and birthed me that way? Mother, may I go back in time and do things different? Maybe smaller and less vocal. A whisper that would say, yes, please, and no, thank you, to save tender insides where my cheeks bled against teeth. Mother, may I explain to you how I learned things were my fault, that I should know better, that pain was a consequence and a punishment so deserved? Did you know that when he hit me and his mouth opened, it was your voice that shrilled against my enamel? Look what you made me do. Mother, may I distance myself across state lines and oceans where you can cross only occasionally to remind me of how things were and weren't? This kaleidoscope of jammed memories that must be real because you say so. Mother, may I remind you that I didn't choose to be your daughter and your albatross, nor did I want to be noticed so much by your hand and wooden spoon. Mother, may I have some peace and quiet, the kind that you always yelled and begged for, even when I tried to be so small.
Very powerful piece. Look what you
Thank
made
you.
Me do line. It seems to resonate, I'm sure, with a lot of people, that blame that comes with the violence. But very powerful.
Thank you. Thank you so much. So the second one is, like I said, I had my son at a really young age, and it's called I'm Supposed to Love You. I'm supposed to love you, but my legs are thin under the white hospital sheet, and a belly I thought would magically suck navel to spine once more is a deflated sponge. There are no cheers for me, just quiet visits and hellos. Everyone's happy that you're well. 10 fingers, all your toes. I still can't make sense of you outside of me. Eyes so wide beneath a knitted cap that they threaten to swallow me whole. I want to say I'm sorry now, because I don't know how to do this thing called mother. My girlhood left me, pushed it all out with you, struggled until my hand shook and molecules quaked. I'm supposed to love you, but I'm not sure how. Why all these tears? Does it happen like magic? Is that how this goes? If so, I'm already failing, and this will be a surprise to no one.
Very nice.
Thank you. Thank you. That one was a difficult one to write.
Have you? What were his thoughts on that one after reading it?
He has a pretty good sense of humor, so it was kind of like, what? I thought this was an amazing, beautiful experience. I think that he was very touched by it, because it's hard for him to imagine being a parent, I think. But I think what he understood from it and what we talked about is that I wanted to love him, and I wanted to be that perfect mother for him, and I wanted to do all the right things, but I was really scared, and I didn't want to mess it up because the responsibility is so huge, you know, and you have this idea that one wrong move and everything will come undone, you know. And so also being young, not having a whole lot of life experience, not having the best experience with my own mother, I wasn't very equipped. I wanted to be, but I was really scared. And I think he has an appreciation for that.
Yeah, I can imagine. So it shows the vulnerability that we're all just humans, especially in a situation that meaningful and sacred.
Mm-hmm.
Well, both of those poems were very touching. What are your plans for the rest of 2019 after this launch takes place? And do you have any other projects lined up at the moment?
I do. I have projects. I have a book coming out with the Hedgehog Poetry Press in December in the UK called Anatomy of a Dress. And it is about how we dress or are expected, historically have been expected to dress ourselves as women, and what kind of messages those convey to ourselves and the people around us. So I'm really excited about that book. But in the meantime, I have a lot of life changes going on, getting married in June, and I am moving. In the fall, I'll be moving to the UK to live with my husband. So a lot of big changes coming, and the book is definitely part of that.
Wow, 2019 is a big year for you, it sounds like, to say the least.
Definitely is. I'm sort of like stepping away from my corporate gigs finally, and I'm gonna be mainly focusing on writing. So it's a whole new chapter in my life. My kids are finishing out their last bit of college, and so everything's changing.
That's amazing. Wish you much success with this book and all the life changes, marriage, moving. That's all brilliant.
Thank you.
I hope that it all goes well, and I want to invite you back on this program anytime that you want to read some more poems and when your next book comes out as well. And
oh, that'd be wonderful.
Yeah, absolutely. Would you like to mention again where people can go to find more information at your website?
Sure, yeah. My website is Juliet Rice, so www.julietrice.com, and it's Juliet with two T's, so J-U-L-I-E-T-T-E, Juliet Rice.
Fantastic. So that's a great Mother's Day gift that people can get here coming up in May, and congratulations on everything, and hope that the month ahead is brilliant for you.
Thanks so much.
Thank you, and hope you have a nice evening ahead, Juliet. Thanks for joining the program tonight.
All right. Thanks so much, Scott.
Thanks. Bye. All right, some powerful work there by Juliet Vandermolen at julietwrites.com. Go check out the book that she has coming out, Mother May I, from Animal Heart Press. And pick up a copy. And like I said, go and call your mothers and tell them that you love them. And we've got about 20 minutes left in the program. Going to open up the phone lines at 646-668-8757. Call in if you'd like to read a couple poems, and we'll be back on the other side after this song by Modest Mouse. This is Satellite Skin.
Wing feelings, powdering dust on your fingers. Well, now we're now praying, we're kneeling, hard enough just to say you believe them. Well, how the heck do you think you could beat them at the stage all that you're trying to be them? Hard enough just to say you don't need. You're forgiven.
Salah here on 17 Numa Radio. Thanks once again to Juliet Vandermolen for calling in this evening. And we're going to go back to the phone lines now. Have a caller from a 910 area code.
Hi, can you hear me? This is Kat.
Yes, I can hear you.
I was hoping actually that Juliet was still on the line. I was on queue for this number to hopefully ask her some questions about her excerpt, and I wanted to personally congratulate her. I'm so proud of this lady. I've been following her work for a while, and I wanted to personally express my gratitude that she continued writing. She's really an amazing woman, and I'm hoping the very best for her book publishing.
Thank you for calling in with those well wishes. She had just dropped off the line about a minute ago, but hopefully she's still listening in and heard those wonderful words that you had for her.
Oh, okay. Well, I'm so glad. I just actually called the number in, and I didn't realize that it was to listen to it. So I had it on like two different phones or something, listening to the radio and her at the same time. But no, I actually was so surprised about the content that she was expressing also. Because a few pieces that I have written and also read by her were very, very racy. Like she does a wide range of writing. I'm not gonna tell on her on the air or anything like that, but she's really verbally expressive, and I just knew in my heart that she was going to pursue writing towards like a career level. And I'm really excited to see what's going to come out of this book.
Yeah, me too. From what I heard here tonight, very powerful themes that she's touching on. And
yes,
I definitely hope that she's still listening in to hear all those praises that you're singing. Are you a writer yourself?
I certainly hope so. Yes. Yes, I am. We actually tweet together a lot on a few little blog pieces that we write for fun on the media map. I'm not sure. Am I allowed to say where or?
Oh yeah, sure.
Well, if there's anybody else that could get offended by it, I'm sorry, but it's actually more like erotic stories. It's called myerotica.com.
Okay, yeah, we're wide open venue here. No one I'm sure.
Okay.
And if so, they tuned into the wrong program anyway. So.
Okay. But yeah, I'm not gonna express that too much because like we're a little bit more like a private sector on Medium. But I was just so amazed by a few of the excerpts that she did have. Just getting back to her on the subject, there's a lot of pieces that she explained about motherhood that really hit home with me, that I wanted to take a moment to express also, because especially with the times that we're living in now, there are so many different types of mothers that are coming out of the woodworks, that are coming out of the Disney princess mold. And we're not, there's no 1950s mold of mothers anymore. I don't personally know of one. My own mother isn't one. And I'm like close to well past my 30s. So I just wanted to really like express and appreciate that there's more of a spotlight going on to a different mold of motherhood, to where, you know, that it is hard. That's the hardest path of life that any woman could ever face. And for her to take the time to express all of her trials and tribulations for the rest of us is a really, really big thing.
Absolutely. The ultimate sacrifice and also the ultimate affirmation of life, all in one.
Yes.
Well, very well said, and thank you so much for calling in and listening tonight.
All right. Thank you so much for your time also.
Absolutely.
All right. Good night.
Nice evening ahead. All right. And we're going to continue along here with another caller. Looks like Mila Bluest on the line. Mila, are you there?
Yeah. Hello, Scott. Yep.
Hey,
hello.
How are you tonight?
I am very good. How are you?
Doing well. It's been a fun show so far. Some intense subject matter, but definitely needs to get out there. And awesome having Juliet on the program tonight.
Yeah, definitely. Thank you so much for doing the show, as always.
Yeah, my pleasure. This is what it's all about, getting people's inspiration out there and pouring their souls
into
the
world. It is. It's really cool to be a part of Animal Heart Press and helping other people, you know, realize that dream, because it wasn't too long ago that I was a total noob and didn't know what I was doing. So it's really neat being like, hey, come over here, write some poetry.
Yeah, absolutely. Can you talk a little bit about what your time at Animal Heart Press has been like so far and what you do there with the social media?
I run the social media, but I also do some, like, behind-the-scenes marketing. Lately, I've been, like, for Juliet, per se, like, calling local radio stations and local libraries and asking them to stock her book or run a new segment of her press release just to try to get word out before the book is released, because that really helps with the pre-orders, and that helps her with sales, and it helps drum up attention for the book.
Yeah, absolutely. I need an agent working on my behalf.
Yeah. I think agents cost money, and I get paid an experience, which is awesome.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, you know how that goes.
That's the boat we're all sailing down right now, I think.
Yeah, but it's actually really fun, because we have a chat group that we all get together, all the editors, and we talk, and we share where we're at and what's going on with the process, and then we joke around, and it's just really great being a part of a lit community like that.
Yeah, absolutely. And there's, as you said, the experiences, those in themselves are priceless, and just where they lead and the connections and just being around other artists, it's all awesome.
Yeah, you know, it's really cool, because a lot of the people that I talk to and that I work with, you know, they all have their MFAs and they are college educated, and I, unfortunately, in my life really veered hard away from that path when I was younger. But just being a part of this community now, I'm really finding that I'm relearning how to market myself, and I'm learning how to write from people that have MFAs. So I'm getting some really amazing tips. I'm like, oh, hey, that's how you do that. And it's really lucky, because honestly, it's, you know, it may only be getting paid, quote, only in experience, but it's actually invaluable.
Yeah, absolutely. On-the-job training, apprenticeship.
Yes, definitely.
All that. So what have you been working on lately?
Just writing, man. You know, I keep kind of revamping the second book that I'm getting ready to release. I've already sent my first collection out for blurb, so unfortunately I can't be all anxious and rewrite that one.
All of them, you have to let them go.
Yeah, you got to let it go. So I actually do have a couple of poems that I'll read that are from the second collection that I'm going to put out, strategically wait until the first book comes out, and then hopefully not obsess over this one anymore. So I have a poem, it's called Dear Moon. Dear Moon, please remember, I never had a chance. I was spinning, dreaming, still drinking. 4 a.m. brings a hungrier creature than your mouth. Thin arms, rope around my pale as the sky neck. Things get fuzzy when you're drunk and clearer in the light of dawn. Dear stars, don't tell the secrets you hold from the night before. This pilgrimage inside my flesh was cheap. What does $20 mean to the sky when the street pays praise to my feet? Following a map of desperation, sucking in the comfort of my sheets, ignoring the blood stains we never washed, souvenirs of my fertility. Dear sky, guide to my spirit journey, wisdom of the ages, guide me home because Point 10 is too drunk to drive and my car is the hollowed shell of a crime scene anyway, where someone kissed the ill-fingered wounds I've dragged around for years, my little fever deaths, running with the wild horses of yesterday, the smell of rot and fertilizer on the Pennsylvania wind, a deserved shitstorm less pungent than the hangover I'll marry in the morning, smelling like the death of my youth.
Oh, wow, what an ending. Nice piece.
Thank you. Much appreciated. So, yeah, that one will be in my second book called Girl Shaped Thing. It's kind of a sequel to what happens when you grow up doing a bunch of dumb shit.
Do you have another piece from that one that you want to read?
Yeah, sure. I'll actually read the title poem, too. It's called Girl Shaped Thing. Yeah, a second. Find it. It's kind of further down in this very long manuscript. Girl Shaped Thing.
Sorry, go ahead.
That's okay. She wants the body, sleep warmed and well-timed, humble and midnight drenched. A home, not like a city. Not like clay or brick, but a building, sturdy, all walls and windows. She craves the teeth, pearlescent and bleached, a flashy thing to bear or gnash, strong enough to bite, a thing of beauty, worn of pain. She grasps for form, all hands reaching or falling, kind of like she holds herself, but more. We all know the similarity, how the timing must be just right, the temperature just so. She knows how it swallows, but spits out the remains, feral, but timid at the same time, how the body lives each day like silk, threads crossed with threads to make a girl-shaped thing, but so delicate, so easily torn, how the mind decides upon resilience and then pleads for death.
Very nice. So these are both coming in your second book. Does your first collection have a set release date yet?
Not a set release date, no. We've informally begun talking about the book, but we haven't begun editing and layout. And that one's with APAP Publications. So it's probably going to be around fall or winter of this year.
Okay. Very cool.
Yep.
Much anticipating
posting
that,
and writing.
Of course. Yeah.
Myself as well. Thank you. But I'll go ahead and hop off of here and hopefully you have some other callers that can read some of their work too.
Yeah, we've got one more on the line. So thank you so much for calling in as always, Mila. And thanks for setting
Juliet up
on the show. And any other Animal Heart Press authors in the future are welcome.
Thank you. I appreciate that so much, Scott. Have a good evening.
You too.
Thanks.
Thank you to Mila Blues for calling in, and we got another caller on the line here at 631 area code. Caller, are you there?
Yeah.
Hi, how are you tonight?
Good, how are you?
Doing very well, thank you.
I was wondering what influenced her on, like, what reason, like, to start the book, and if it was, like, something or someone.
That's a very good question. Unfortunately, Juliet isn't on the line any longer, but if you go to her website at julietwrites.com, there is a contact email that you can find there. And
okay.
I'm sure that you can send that question her way, and she'll be happy to give you more information on it.
All right, awesome.
Very good. Well, thank you for calling in.
No problem. Have a good night.
You as well. Thank you. All right. So once again, anyone looking to get in touch with Juliet can reach her at julietwright.com. Find her on Twitter and Instagram as well. And there's more information about her forthcoming book about to release on May 3rd. So I want to thank her again for joining the program, as well as Mila Bluest. And we're coming to the end of the show here. Once again, please join in next Monday on the 6th when Matt Borgzone will be my guest. And until then, hope everyone has an awesome week ahead. Gonna send it out with Trees by Manchester Orchestra. Cheers.
Oh, this song's called Trees.
Okay to lose, so then it gets you heavy.